Okay, so friends, so welcome to from an exciting world of CNIB to a different world altogether, actually. This world is a shift, so to say, from a completely organized setup industry to a cottage industry. We would see a change in the whole scenario of how services are being provided in developing countries. I'll just focus on a few of the challenges and why these capacity building efforts are required in developing countries, for these developing countries to be able to participate as authorized entities in this TIGA project. And we may also notice that here, when we say developing countries, the majority of the population of persons with brain disabilities actually reside in developing countries. So we are talking anywhere between 75% to 85% of persons with brain disabilities actually living in developing countries. And we are also saying that that the developing countries can actually be the biggest beneficiaries of international exchange. The amount of content in languages such as English, Spanish, French, etc., which has been created already in organizations such as CNIB or Royal National Institute of the Blind in UK or in Spain or in countries like you can say Norway or Sweden, all that content which has been created in developing countries, if we are looking at the similar content, we don't want to recreate, or we don't want to waste resources, scarce resources of developing countries, to recreate those content, but to take benefit of the international exchange and to get those content in the hands of end users living in developing countries. So this is the biggest potential beneficiary, and the large number of beneficiaries that we are talking about, which are actually living in the world where a lot needs to be done in terms of enhancing their capacities. Now, when it comes to compliance to become an authorized entity, the first thing that we need at least is to know the beneficiaries. The entities which are serving persons with brain disabilities need to have a record at least to show that that the distribution is actually happening only for persons with brain disabilities. That level of at least information and protection needs to be provided with these entities. Now, I'll just relate a small example to my recent visits to Bangladesh and Sri Lanka. And here the organizations where we visited, where we are involved in doing the capacity building, to my question on are you actually registering each and every member that comes to you for your to take benefit of your library, unfortunately answers in both these organizations was no. So there is no full process of registering beneficiaries, and the simple argument there is, the person who's standing beside me is a person with blindness, and I know that this person is a person with blindness. And where is the requirement of, where is the doubt that this book is actually going to a non-authorized person? I know this argument would not hold good when it comes to actually recognizing such an entity as an authorized entity. So there is a level of capacity building or a challenge that is there, which is required. Not only to maintain such records, but to actually maintain records of transactions or what books are being given to which members and how many copies are being distributed. Then when it comes to the legal framework and policies, again, quite a large number of developing countries that the things are actually wanting means that the copyright exceptions or the rules or the kind of special licensing under which organizations can actually produce and distribute books in accessible format to persons with brain disabilities, the laws are not very clear as they are in most of the developed countries. India, for example, passed a law for making this whole distribution completely legalized was as late as in May 2012. So before that, I guess people like me should have been sitting in the jail, actually. Fortunately, I'm sure it has escaped that. Now, capacity, what is also required in developing countries is that even though we are talking that the publishers or the Tiger systems are going to provide the in an exchange program, provide certain files in some specified format to these authorized entities. Now these authorized entities need to be trained to be able to use those files and to convert them into the exact format or copy them onto the exact medium that the end user wants. So, and why I say that the capacity building is required because of another reality that I would just want to bring forward, that this skill human resource in the organizations which are running the show in developing countries is actually not there. I haven't seen, for example, in my entire career of 20 years in working in developing countries in this very sector, a single qualified librarian managing a library in any of those. And I can tell you in these 20 years, I must have seen more than 100 such libraries working. And not even a single qualified librarian who's employed to manage such libraries. There is no qualified engineers actually managing the IT systems in there. They are being manned primarily by volunteers. There were some library. When I started working, for example, in 1993 in National Association for the Blind in Delhi, the whole library, there was a talking book library, but there was no paid employee who was giving the service. The entire library was even managed, the whole distribution system, production system, was entirely managed by volunteers only. And this is something that we see very often in different parts of developing countries. So that is why the capacity needs to be created in these countries wherever we go in for the authorized entities, so that at least they are able to make use of these files which are going to reach them as a result of international exchange. Now, there was a thought also that okay, we are going to provide, we are going to have certain low-income group countries in various regions of the world, where they might not be producing themselves today, but they would be mainly seen as the beneficiaries of receiving files from the authorized entities. And a big question on what Judith raised today, whether we can actually recognize an organization which is not a producer being recognized as an authorized entity. I think in the low income group countries, I guess we will not be having much choice. But yeah, I also saw that part of the argument that even if this entity is even authorized to create, I guess that would result in its qualification. But we might see a lot of organizations such, in especially in low-income group countries, who might be just the beneficiaries, not the computers, to the international exchange program. But then the reality also remains that in these countries also, unless there is country-specific, country-relevant and books are not available, then just giving the books which are from the international entities might not actually serve the whole purpose. It may help, but it may not serve. And this is where I would want to bring in our experience with the Bookshare India project. So we overnight one day, when we signed an MOU with Bookshare operating in US, that we would offer this service in India at an affordable cost, which is at the cost where Indians can afford, or the cost is sort of relevant for Indian members. Overnight, there were about more than 50,000 books that were made available to persons with print disabilities in India. We thought that as soon as we open this service in India, we will face a challenge of how will we manage such a large request base from members. Well, unfortunately, to our very sad surprise, the uptake was not all that huge. And when we investigated the reasons, everybody said that yes, these are the books which are produced in US, published by US publishers or some international publishers. But what we need are books which are produced by Indian publishers. These are our first requirements. The international publishers' requirements come second. So unless you are able to serve us or give us books which are our primary requirement, these are obviously not going to serve that whole purpose. So why I'm bringing this is that whenever we go in for capacity building in developing countries for these authorized entities, we should not go with this myth that just by providing international files we will be able to give a complete solution. So where each and every capacity building activity will have to take this into consideration, that along with the international files, the local files are also the production of local files and the collaboration with local publishers is part of all this capacity building activity. And when we talk of capacity building, we are also saying that this capacity building also needs to be done not just for the organizations serving persons with blindness and low vision, but we also are talking about the publishers actually. And even the publisher community does require capacity building in the developing countries to be able to participate and contribute. What we found was especially in Bangladesh, for example, the publisher community actually was very eager and very, very forthcoming to contribute to this process. But they actually didn't know what they need to do to contribute. Their workflows were not such which even if they wanted to contribute, they could not, because their workflows brought those files or created such files which could not be used for capacity building. And I will deal with some of those specific problems in my next slide. So a lot of capacity building again needs to go in with the publishers and the right owners as much as it needs to be done with the communities, with the organizations dealing with persons with blindness and low vision. Okay, so here we are, I'm just sharing some of those practical challenges that we faced when we undertook certain capacity building activities in countries. So my experience in India for all those many years, plus the recent capacity building activities that we have done on behalf of WIPO. So these are the challenges which I am sharing, which cover those things. So we actually also, these challenges are also based on a gap analysis study that DAISY Consortium undertook in collaboration with the World Blind Union. And this was done in 23 developing countries which had 76 languages, national languages or languages in which the textbooks are published. So obviously we know that the number of languages can be very large, but these are 76 languages or 23 countries which actually books are published, right? So we did a gap analysis survey in accessing published materials for persons with blindness and low vision in these countries. And the findings that are there as part of this is the first thing that we noticed is that in most of the developing countries, in fact, you can say as high as almost 98% of these developing countries, the publishers and the VI community have never seen each other's faces. I mean, they have been working completely in isolation. And the publisher community is completely unaware of the requirements of persons with blindness and low vision. And the VI community, VIP organizations had no idea how much they could have gained or never set processes in a way, never took it into account that they could actually get into a win-win situation if they actually work with the publishers instead of working in isolation from the publishers. So many of our actually these capacity building activities that we undertake, we are able to build these bridges in those countries. So those very positive things have started happening actually in those countries where we have undertaken the capacity building work. Now this is the second problem which is listed here is very typical and very specific to developing countries, I would say. People who are operating in English or in most of the European languages won't even know the terminology which is being used here. We can't even imagine in this world, in Europe and US, that there can be fonts which will not comply to a standard font coding system. And a simple symptom of that is that when we select a text in a file and we can change the font, and yet English will remain English. It won't turn to some other garbage if you change the font. But if the font is actually not compliant to Unicode standards, this is what happens with the languages. You select a sentence written in Hindi, and if the font is not Unicode compliant, you apply a different font of Hindi, and this text will then become garbage. You will not see Hindi anymore on the screen. And this has got very disastrous implications for accessibility, because my screen reading software doesn't see the shape on the screen. My screen reading software only reads the digital code embedded in the computer on a digital device. And when this code itself is not standard, whether you are able to see that text on the screen or not, my screen reading software will always read it as a garbage. It will not be, so in a simple language, if a font is not Unicode compliant, and mind you, that's a simple language actually. So if a font is not Unicode compliant, my screen reading software will not be able to read Hindi if that text is Hindi actually. My Braille translation software will not be able to translate into Braille if that is not Unicode compliant. So it's quite a big, and I would say a very, very disastrous kind of a situation that we are in actually. Because as soon as we talk about collaboration or getting files from publishers in the local language, most of those files are non-standard font files. That means they can't be used, whether even if we want to, even if publisher is contributing, this can't be used for accessible book production. And it's a huge challenge which we are sort of trying to address in this thing. And this is being seen as, you know, trying to bring standards into this era, and there's more desperate requirement for us. But yes, it is good for everybody, because a non-Unicode font actually doesn't work on your mobile devices also. So for general persons also, this has got a huge implication. But this is a thing which is more aggressively being pushed by the VIP community in these countries. The next point which I say is, I think I've just said that the service is actually just provided as a voluntary service by a few philanthropic, good-hearted people. It's not run like a professional library, and when it is done in that way, the metadata of the books are not recorded properly. The membership records are not maintained the way they should be. So those kind of challenges we run into. And the next point about the fragmentation of the delivery system, like Canada has got one CNIB, and there is no requirement for any other organization to exist, I guess, because it will be able to, one single organization is able to serve everybody in Canada or maybe even outside Canada who is a Canadian citizen, and they will all be able to get a service from a single organization. But in a developing country, in a city like Colombo where we were, there were five organizations trying to provide services, and yet the services do not reach. And these five organizations would have just 100 books or 200 books, and on the largest library of Sri Lanka had 1,000 books in their catalog, and they were so proud of themselves. But we know that these are not enough, and they're all divided, trying to do something on their own with completely charity money, because they're not being funded from a single source by any means. And this whole delivery system is so fragmented, which is also getting resulting into duplication of work. So I use a there is a special mathematics that goes in developing countries for accessible books, where 1 + 1 = 1. Because why that happens is that two organizations are producing one book. At the end of it, ideally, you should have at least two titles available for end users. But what happens is that one organization doesn't know what the other organization is doing. And often, when there are demands for especially like study materials, you'll find two organizations trying to produce same title. So although two organizations have worked on one title each, yet the number of titles which are available is still one, because both of them have worked on the same title. So that's the special mathematics of fragmented services in developing countries. And then you come to technology gaps. Of course, in a country like India, where we have 22 official languages, where books are produced, where people are getting do their complete education in a particular language. So 22 of those exist in India. Out of those, the text-to-speech engine, which allows any of my devices to work in that language, exists only for two. So rest of the 20, even if I provide a publisher file, a text-only file, there is no digital device that will be able to read that thing out. So similarly, the availability of Braille translation softwares, I think these are some very critical gaps that needs to be plugged in when all these books actually, if we have to provide a complete and comprehensive solution. And of course, affordability of devices which are required, such as Daisy players, or I can't even name refreshable Braille display as of now, because it's just completely out of bound. If I say that refreshable Braille display could be provided in a country, in a developing country, it's just completely out of question. If a single refreshable Braille display could take almost full 1.5 years salary of a person who's working as a teacher in this developing country. So it's, and even things like Daisy players, there are not many subsidy schemes running in developing countries, and the cost of these players in comparison to the income levels in the developing countries are actually very high. Because like recently, I took a Daisy player for a person in Sri Lanka, and I was eventually wanting to understand the whole purchase power system in the country for the solution. And I learned that lady had actually spent full 1 month salary just to get one basic Daisy player. So it's a significant amount of money that one will need to spare out if they have to possess assistive technology. Okay. So after these challenges, I hope I have not sort of overwhelmed to make you very, very negative about this whole system, but things are moving, and we are actually wanting to change this world in developing countries with our initiatives. So I'm going to just share certain kind of initiatives that we are doing in as part of our capacity building activities in few countries where we are gone, so that we can get some ideas on this. So we are organizing trainings. We already interacted with organizations in Bangladesh, for example, with the VIP community, with publishers community, with end users. We have spoken to representatives of end users, and we understood their problems. And with that, we are designing the training programs. We'll be delivering those training programs, because fortunately, all the stakeholders are willing to work. They're willing to work together to solve this problem. And we are going to provide training so that they can actually do it. Unfortunately, we could not provide some basic ICT equipment to in these countries because of the restrictions of what can be done under WIPO's project here. But yes, the organizations have been able to get some support from other sources to fill up this deficiency of capacity building. Now, the whole capacity building program is built around this workflow where publishers are involved and we'll get books from publishers and those will be then transferred to the VIP community and they will be able to produce accessible books using the publisher files. And this workflow, we are working towards putting together this workflow and implementing this workflow with at least few publishers that are taking lead in this domain. We know that it might not be possible for doing the library management or member management or this transaction documentation process by hand. So we are actually working towards creating a IT-based solution where the even with the non-librarian community, they will be able to actually maintain all these systems with the required metadata and with all the transactions put in place. So an IT-based solution actually is being introduced in these countries to do all that management to get records, periodical records that we and especially the publishers would be happy to have. We are also introducing book reading equipments there, which will be given on loan to end users, which will become a teaser for the local government actually to start providing such similar services. And as a pilot study, we do scoping. We say that we are not going to provide the solution to the entire population of a country, but at least create a pilot for, say, university-going students of three universities, and we would come up with a comprehensive solution for that set of students, so that the same model could be replicated. And because we want to make sure that all components of capacity building are actually introduced, and there are no half-baked works which are introduced in these countries. So this is where we are. I guess our task is very challenging. It's a lot of work for us to do, but the intentions are there. We are entering into a new world where this cottage industry needs to be transformed into a more organized sector, and I guess the times ahead are very exciting for developing countries, especially in light of this TIGR project, international exchange, and the Marrakesh Treaty. Thank you.